knowledge about genomes. I guess that Samuel has told you about how a genome looks like and what is different between these types of genomes. Oh, you know that? So how big is the human genome? Three billion bases of genome or DNA, how many of these are coding for genes? We have a guess. We start from the top. 3 billion? 2 billion?
3%.
3%, yeah. It's about 10 billion. So this is a very small fraction. If you take go to E. coli, how big is E. coli? It's in the order of millions of base pairs. It's 5 or something like that. In that order. And you know what fraction is coding for genes there? The 3% in human genome, you think it's more or less? More. Is it 30%? 90%? I think it's about 90%. Basically, it's all coding. So what is the reason for this? Why is it? There are several reasons. One reason is, of course, that there is a very strong advantage for bacteria to have a small genome. But it's not such a strong advantage, for a high organism like ourselves to have a small genome. So it has not been a strong selective pressure to reduce the size. If it would have been very good, a big advantage, like any human that had a smaller genome would have more kids, then we probably would have a smaller genome, but it's not. And of course that because of we spend most of our energies doing other things than copying our genomes. It's only a very small fraction of our cells are actually involved in creating offspring. It's only the cells involved in the reproduction. The rest of the body is doing other things. The cells are much bigger, there are a lot of other things around it, and there are much larger factors on the cost. But in bacteria, if it suddenly gets a lot of energy, it can start copying the genome very quickly, then that bacterial cell can outcompete around others. So it's good to be smaller. If it's a smaller genome, you can copy it faster, you waste less energy on making nucleotides and all the other things around you need. I mean, it's not the only thing you need, but it's one part of it. And then there are, of course, a lot of other reasons why we have big genomes. We have different machineries, we have splicing that affects prokaryotes, and so on. What is the cause, what is the consequence, is not clear. But clearly, there's not a strong prediction, strong reason to have small genomes. So that, of course, affects gene prediction. So gene prediction, basically, given a genome, I want to tell where it is. So how would you do that? What do you think we can do? Genome sizes, so basically, you see, there is some correlation that we have more genes than bigger genomes, but it sort of levels out to somewhere around tens of thousands. This is viruses, prokaryotes, and eukaryotes. And it's a bigger big. And in particular, there are some genomes that are extremely big, like some plants, and they don't have many more genes, but they are basically got repeated elements. But it is here, that basically in prokaryotes, it's quite linear thing, but basically it's full of genes. So basically, if you need more genes, you need a bigger genome. And viruses also. So of course we know the idea, of course, we know this is something already loaded.
So this is sort of tells you what the gene is. So we have something that we call a gene that's stored in the DNA. And the gene is also replicated sometimes, but you have transcription to an mRNA, and then you have translation to a protein. So anything in the region here that becomes a protein is gene, because you can think. But I'm not sure that's really, do you know any other genes that are not doing that? That are not here? Well, if you take the tRNAs, they are RNA molecules, or the ribosome. Most of the ribosome is RNA. So that is a part, and certainly the ribosome is certainly a gene, something that is fundamental in all life is a gene. But it's never made to a protein. So there are a number of RNA genes. And what has been discovered in the last decade or so is that there are probably many more RNA genes than we thought, but shorter, longer. And many of them are probably involved in regulation. But the classical ones are, of course, the tRNAs, the ribosome, and some other big machineries that have RNA genes. So they are, and of course, it goes back to somehow the idea of how life started, is the idea of somebody's original life might have been RNA. So you might have an RNA word, but then the proteins come later. But that's so somehow a main speculation. So anything that sort of is expressed and from in DNA and copied to RNA, you call it gene. And often you also include elements that sort of regulate this DNA stretch. So you have transcription binding factors, you have in the eukaryotic genes, you have splicing signals, and so on. So there are things that are surrounding it, can be quite far away, but then are often included in the gene. Because it's not always the whole RNA that's, particularly in eukaryotes, of course, you have an mRNA here that is spliced, so there's some part which is extracted protein, but you call the whole thing the gene. So we want to detect from the genome, what are the genes? So what can we do? So what kind of thing now? We sort of ignore most of the RNA genes, because they are, we mainly focus on protein genes. So to do that, we can do a lot of this data. So assume that this is classical. You're involved in a genome project, so for some reason you want to sequence a new genome. You find your favorite bug or favorite animal or something that you want to sequence the genome. So then, of course, you run a lot of sequencing and you make a nice assembly of the whole thing. Then you want to sit down and say, this is the genes that are here. These genes exist, these do not exist. These are very different from whatever. And of course, nowadays it's quite different from what the people did in the beginning, because in the beginning you had no genome to compare with. Now, of course, there are many other genomes. So it's very unlikely that your genome is completely unrelated to everything else out there. But that was not the case in the beginning. There still can be, particularly if you find some very strange, rare organisms. So basically you have some kind of computer-based gene region. You just take a sequence of the genome and you do a prediction of this region. And then you can have some kind of expression data. So you can basically look, you might have RNA data for that organism. Expressive. So basically, if you know that if you have the RNA, you can sort of map the RNA back to the genome and say, this might be gene. However, there are a lot of eukaryotic projects that show that there are a lot of expressions that does not appear to match to known genes. So you have the ENCODE project that basically says that 90% of the human genome is expressed. I don't think anybody believes that 90% of the human genome consists of genes. So there's probably some spontaneous expression for some reason that happens, and the RNA sequencing is so sensitive, so it picks up that also. So it's not obvious, it's not always because you find one RNA molecule to match some part of the genome that is the gene.
you have to be there for the noise and development of purpose. You can have genetic data, so of course you might have look at variation, you look at your favorite organism and some other related organisms that are also there, and you see what the variation, or you have a population, if you have bacteria, you can take samples from many different diseases, and, see, you know, and you would say that areas that are conserved are more likely to be genes than the areas that are not conserved. And you can, similarly, you can search databases, so basically if you find the region of your DNA, and it's similar to something else that's already annotated as a gene, that's more likely to be a gene. And then you select a database, and then you maybe put it released to the public, and you get new data, and you keep on doing that for a while. So let's look a bit more at... So this is type of, if you look at basically view the gene type of data used, so of course we know from our old textbooks that there are very specific start-stop codons. We know that most proteins start with AUG, so they have a methionine in the first position. There are some variation, but in general, that's majority of that. And we know that 3 out of the 64 possible codons are stop codons. So if you have a random sequence, how long would on average a protein coding region be? So you have 3 codons out of 64 that code for a stop codon.
Every 20?
Yeah. So every 20, so on average, of course, there's going to be some distribution, but on average, every 20. And how long is the normal protein? Basically, it's quite unlikely that you find a region of 100 amino acids or 300 nucleotides without stop codon, if it's random. So basically, the first thing you start, and you know you have a start codon, so first thing you start, you take all the start codons and you look, everything that's longer than 50 residues or 100 residues without stop codon, that's most likely to be a gene. And it's pretty good estimated in the first case. It gets more complicated in eukaryotes, which have splicing. I'll come back to that in a second. There you have the exons and introns, and the exons are actually shorter often, so they are, then it's harder to find them. But so you have, but they have signal splicing also, so that is something you look for. Then you have transcription binding sites, you have, and ribosome binding sites have specific patterns. Both in that site, different eukaryotes and prokaryotes. Yes, for the major sites. There are things in the gene that you can look for. You make a computational model that takes into account. There also are often, depending on the organism, there are often some kind of new compositions. For instance, there are often more GCs, particularly the third codon, because you know, of the 64 codons, there are only 61 codons, they only code for 20 amino acids. In most, for many cases, the third codon is not important, because you code the same amino acids independently of what you have in the third codon. Not always, but for a large fraction of this codon is like that. So if you look at the nucleotide compositions, you tend to have more GCs, D or Cs, in the third position than you have non-coding part of the genome. But yeah, you have like stop codon cells, and there are also some other patterns you look at. Some codons are more frequent than others, etc. But it varies from organism to organism. And then, of course, you have the idea of searching your sequence for match to known genes. So nowadays, it's the first thing you do, of course, is if you say that you want to sequence a new bacteria, you will, of course, take the most similar bacteria you can find and match this genome search. And it's most of the genes are going to be the same, so there are going to be some additional new ones and some that have been lost for some reason. And the genome itself can be very reshuffled, because there are a lot of reshuffling in genomes that can happen quite quickly. But certainly the essential genes are going to be there in the new organism also. And as I said, you can match to cDNA or RNA-seq data. And also, just look at the conservation. Like basically, a hallmark of a gene, almost a definition of a gene, is something that's under selective pressure. So like basically, it varies less than the background. less variation.
So this is an overview of this, basically more or less what I told in the last slide. So you have some transcription start site. You have a shiny garden sequence here that has mainly this kind of pattern. And you have your ABG and the ribosome binding site here. So you have a long region here with other stop codons, primary stop codons. And after you have kind of a loop here and the TTC that's the transcription termination site. So basically, you want to make a computer model that sort of can model, identify all these type of things. So this here binds to the ribosome sequence, it's sort of important. Mm-hmm. So what you do, you take your, assuming you have a genome and you want to do a gene assignment only on using this, that sequence and nothing else. Then you search for all possible ORs in all six reading frames. Do you understand that we can do both directions? So yeah, and you know what the reading frame is? So I think I have a slide on the next slide. So basically, of course, you can start in any position. It's not, I mean, you have three codons, but you don't know we can start from. So in theory, if you have a genome sequence, you can start anywhere, and you can do from 3' to 5', or 5' to 3', you can do both directions. So you have six. So the number of possible coding regions is basically six times the length of the genome. You calculate this kind of, you search for all these possible ones. You basically search for all the ones that are long enough. Basically, start codon, you look at all the start codons, and then you look at the ones that are long enough. You sort of screen for this on the, you have some, you can basically predict proteins and look at amino acid codons and so on, and you can see if they are, you have, basically look at the output and you can iterate a few things. Yeah. So one of the things that I use is GC richness. So it's a program called test code, and you can just look at here, there is a gene region here, and if you look at the GC of the third codon, much better is a bit of force, but then this region is much higher. And it goes back down. Yeah. And it's just some program that basically makes some kind of scoring from that one to this one. That's. So that's one thing that you can use. I heard that you talk about hidden market models. So this is often one of the perfect, you want to model something, and you want to model something that is probably within a hidden market model is perfect for this. So basically you model the start codon here and you see you have A, T, G, and you have 80% chance of being A, 97% of being T, and 97% of being G. So basically that shows that there are some that are GTG also or TTG, but basically you have model that can take it all into this account, but it's much more likely to be a gene if you have an AUG or ATG in the first position. And then you have your coding region, of course. You basically make it as a sort of a triplet, because you want it to be protein coded, so you have only three, then you have three nucleotides in each amino acid. And you see that there are some differences here between the typical coding region and non-typical coding region. So here you see that you have the third codon. You have G and C's. The G's here are much more frequent than they are here. C's are actually lower for some reason. But you have some difference here. You see that you have, for some reason, you have many A's in the second position. I don't know why, but. And in the first one. So there are some differences here. And they talk about in the book also that you can make higher order in the model. So basically, because there are amino acid patterns, so it's not like all amino acids are equally likely to be followed by another one.
It's unlikely to two funds next to each other, for instance. So they are not independent. I'm not sure how strong that thing is, but that's what you talk about in the book. And so basically, you can make this called sort of a, what they call the higher order of market models. You basically say the probability of the second one depends on the first one. And then you improve things a little bit. And then you have a stop code in here. This is basically going to be TA. T, for instance, or TAA. And I guess it's there.
So if I understood that question, if I understood correctly, this model of nucleotides is then linked to one of amino acids.
Yes, or basically, I think they don't do it linked to amino acids. I think they link it to codons. Basically, the second codon is dependent on the first codon.
Okay.
So I think they are basically depending on what you have here, and probably have the other one later. I think that's what they do, which is probably just the sum of all the codons for amino acids. It's basically the same thing, but I don't think it never really translated. So basically, the distribution of hexa. Yeah, sorry. Yeah, it should be high. I don't know why C is not high here. I don't know.
The second
plus
also T is high.
Yeah. G is high here. I don't know why C is lower than that. I don't know. And it's just numbers from the book. I don't know if this is just what they wrote or they released this in the data. I can't say. I guess it's like that, but for me, I would assume that. But it's not that it really depends on the genome, because it depends on the GC content of the whole genome. So it could be. I don't know why, but it's. I would have thought that both CD should be higher, but I don't know why. So I just noticed. So basically, this is kind of the higher order. So basically, what you do is you provide probabilities not for one nucleotide, but for, in this case, actually five nucleotides. And if you have GCTAC, you have a certain precision probability to something that starts with all these, so the higher. So you can only go from this one to this. So basically, you have you take a probability for all five at the same time. The problem is, of course, you need much more data to train. You have to count much more, so you have more statistics. And then you basically go. Then this is the way. So you don't do a transition of one nucleotide, but then you put the probability of any other, by all combination of five nucleotides. So they are. So if you want to do a higher order, you can do a model. You need lots of many more. If you have a higher order probability or a higher bottom model, you need many more parameters. And basically, you only have limited amount of data. You don't have data enough for it. And then there is a program called EMM, which is basically tries to optimize these parameters. Basically, you can say, okay, what is the best higher order parameter? And you can balance these things together. And they do it by basically optimizing all the probabilities. Yes, that's really so much of one. And using this in the typical test case of some small bacteria, and because this is a bacteria that someone has manually annotated. Accurate. This is one of the most influences, very small one, it's only 1,700 genes. And you basically see that the best model today will do like 98% correct. So they basically do at least some 10 genomes and a pretty few extra one. If you see, they compare some simple in the market model, there are still 54 amounts, you only 91%. So you can push these things in the bacterial genome to close to 100%, but like 98% correct. But still, of course, this shows you cannot only have this. If you want 100% correct, you need to do manual work also and have additional data.
Sorry, what
What? This is true positives and false negatives. So it means I will actually talk about that next week. So basically, if you have true positives is basically just out of this 1,717. They predicted 1,680 was correctly predicted, so they missed 37. So the false negatives, so basically what they missed, is equal to 1,717 minus 1,680, which is then 37. So this is the false negatives, so it means 37. And then they predicted 209 false positives. So they basically predicted 209 extra. So they predicted another 209 genes that are not in that are wrong, that are over predicted. And then these are the false positives.
What do you mean by precision in the last sentence? It's not clear if it's precision. Is precision the same as sensitivity, what you're meaning?
Yes.
Okay.
We'll come back to that next week.
So when we say that if it is false positive, so if we are looking for unknown genomes, then how can we say it is not a novel gene or it is just a false
positive? No, I mean, we can't, of course. And then this is why I guess where they have a question mark here. But I mean, even this is of course one of the problems is that you never really know when a gene is a gene. I mean, you know some kind of when it's a gene, but if it's something that you have that you predict to be a gene, how do you prove that it's not a gene? It's really quite difficult to say that this is not a gene, because like, sure, you can look at conservation, you can look at expression data, but maybe in some rare circumstance, some lifestyle, some part of the cell cycle, it is actually expressed and important. But then the rest of the time, normally it's not. So it is not easy to say that something is not a gene. Now, Haemophilus influenza is extremely well characterized and extremely well studied. So people have knocked out every gene, knocked out every part of it. So it's certainly it's quite likely to be correct. But if there's a bacteria you don't know, it's very hard to say it. And particularly it's for the many short proteins, short genes, that were missed for many years. Because you don't see them. And as I said, if you look at the RNA-seq data, there probably are some expression of things that are, I mean, you can see signals of something in RNA expressed, but it's probably some type, sometimes some background expression that just, bind them, it's biophysical, so sometimes bind is expressed, so you can see there, but does it really have an importance? I mean, maybe it has in some specific circumstance. If you put it in high temperature, maybe it becomes very important, the science rest of time. So it's hard, it's very hard to say. That I guess is a question mark instead. So this is, the round is here, some other data here is here, yeah. It's even better data here, and they have in the order 99, 96, so sensitivity is 99%, specificity is 90%, so they have like 2%, 2-3% extra prediction things, so they have in the order of a handful. So the methods are pretty good for bacterial genomes, but this is also quite an advanced, I mean if you simple method you go and you end up with results like this, it's often how you present things, which is not what I don't do, but you see here, you see possible, and you can look at the reading frames, and you have some kind of debugs into our genes, and you see here you have an inactive sequences, and see if you have the ones that frame shift, you see you have a lot of stop codes here and there. So that's what you, this is sort of what you expect randomly, you will see something high, stop codes, or what, you don't see, you see long things, and then you have one six to do this. So basically, people spend time going through the whole genome. And then you present it and you compare what is regulatory and you have binding factors and so on. Okay, now we go to eukaryotes. So of course, this is sort of the idea of a eukaryotic genome, or a eukaryotic gene, which is much more complicated. You still have a transcription start site, and you have something called a Kozak sequence, which is much more less conserved because it changes the garden sequence, and it has the ATD there, and looks like that. And then you have exons, and introns can be very long, it can be thousands of nucleotides. And of course you have alternative splicing, sometimes you skip one exon, you go with this one and this one, and sometimes they even like, you get half of this, or not half of this, and it's another complicated thing. And you have, and then of course, there is some kind of placing on the Stockholm era. So it's, and these are often shorter than the length of the protein, so they are hard to find just because of that reason. And then there's mRNA splicing, and you end up with a gene, which is called a mature RNA. And you have a fiber cap and start with them. So going from this one to this one is not at all as easy. So, but you use similar ideas. I mean, it's not exactly the same preferences, but of course, it's the same type of ideas. And sometimes you use what we talk about next week is a machine learning method for neural networks. And basically, you take in all these things together, you basically balance and then you predict something. Is this in an exon or not an exon? So you use machine learning. We will talk much more about machine learning next week, but not for this problem. And yeah, so you end up with something. You have exons and you have models for initial content. There are even different models for beginning and end of an exon. And you have the stop and start site of exons, and you have coding regions that are also a bit different. So you have basically a Hilbert model that does the same thing, but it's more complicated. And of course, well, we know that reading frame is important. Same thing again. And of course, you match things often to known, to get this to work. You want to match it to expressed sequence tags, so match it to RNA sequence that are known, that helps a lot. But so this is basically the same type of table we had before. And you can see here, of course, the main thing you can see here is that the other cases, these things were like 95, 90, was like 99%, this was like 96%. And here there are numbers in the 90s and maybe 95. Maybe gene scan is pretty good. Yeah, 95, 90, or that's, or HMM gene is 93, 93. But it's only better than 75%. So still, we miss 10% of genes, and we have 10% extra. So if you have 20,000 genes in the human, you probably miss 2,000, you have 2,000 extra. So it's clearly much more difficult. So you really need much more manual work. You need much more matching to other genomes and so on. So for a long time, for instance, it was well known that the rat genome was very bad. It was really hard to use some of it because it was basically, they had done all the analysis and assigned it and did the first draft of it. But then nobody really took the effort to sit down and do it again. And then it was probably something that would take a year for someone to do. Better experience. And we just optimized because they had to go through every gene to basically see something wrong. I mean, and so it happened in a minute. If you go study something in detail, you realize that I missed an exon, or there's an extra exon, things like that. So it's not easy to do it automatically. And these are those methods that use all this type of information. So just to end, I have some summary. So main thing is much easier to do gene prediction in prokaryotes than in eukaryotes. It's quite difficult to stick it alone as in eukaryotes. If you have a homology to either to express the expression data or to other genomes, it's much. It helps a lot, but anyway, it's not perfect, eukaryotes at least. And one of the main problems is short genes. Short genes are always harder than long genes. Or short exons also. There are often pseudogenes. So basically, genes are not very important in a bacteria, might degenerate. You basically have a stop code in the middle of it. So, or the start site is destroyed. It is not expressed. And of course, that might be a subpopulation question, so it might be just part of the population that do it. But it might also be something there actually is a gene that is on the way out of the population. So you have, sometimes you have to take the whole population of, into account, because there are individual variations.
Well, and the basic question, yes, exactly.
Just because something looks like a gene, is it really a gene? Most likely, but certainly, but, it's always hard to tell, because you really, you would need to be, have, let's find some function for it. Maybe you, if you want to knock, if you knock it out, you would like to have some effect. But the effect might only be seen in one, some very rare circumstances. So they have, so you, it's well known that you can knock out more than half the genes in most bacteria and still are perfectly happy. But that doesn't mean that they are as fit. It means that in some circumstances they are maybe not as happy. So they have been seen some of these attempts to make minimal genomes. You only have 500 genes or something like that, and you make minimum ones. And sure, they live, but they're probably not as good generally as a bigger genome. And so certainly some manual creations. That was my last slide. So, any questions before lunch? No more questions. Have a lunch. Then I'll see you on Monday and I'll talk about phylogeny. There are some features that we could do before. Let's go and time.